Good morning and happy Easter to you. Happy Easter to everyone who is here, to everyone who is tuned in remotely, and for those of you who may be watching us later, happy Easter. I have announcements here somewhere. Yes. So just as a reminder, we have this pink folder. It's back on the welcome desk. If you want to pick that up, if you're here each week, it has lyric sheets for the week, and it also has a handful of announcements. And I'm going to highlight some of those announcements now. And this week, I'll try to do them in order, whereas in a previous week, I tried to announce the growth groups out of order. So this will hopefully be a little tidier than that was. So today is Easter Sunday, and for those parents who haven't figured it out yet, we are not having children's church. So there are going to be more children in here. And to accommodate that, we have the folders. There's some back by the back door. There's an activity sheet inside. It's got like a little pencil and crayons and some coloring sheets and activity sheets inside. So if you have kids, feel free to grab those to keep them distracted if you would like. But there will be children here. There is still nursery today, but we don't have the children's church time. The next thing in line is that after the service today, if you ordered cookies for life, to support life, those are getting distributed today in the kitchen, right? Yes. So after the service, you can't go before that, but after the service, you can go and get your cookies, and there might be a couple extra for those who are interested in still helping support that. Next, this week is our growth groups week. So we had our first Wednesday, we had the second Wednesday of hospitality, and this is the third Wednesday. So the 20th, 21st, and 22nd, we're having growth groups this week. And then that means that next week, on the 27th, we'll be having corporate prayer. And the theme for this time will be for growth groups. So please join us. You don't have to be in a growth group for that. We're just going to be praying for that ministry that is happening in the church. So if you are not in a growth group, please still come. And if you are in a growth group, please consider coming to pray for the ministry in which you are involved. So that'll be next Wednesday, the 27th, will be growth groups. And then finishing off the month on the 30th, we have the spring work day. So if you're available to come that day, we'll have things to work on around the church. So please join us for that. Also, I'd like to mention a couple prayer highlights for a couple of our missionaries. The Nusses, I'm going to pray for them in just a second, for God to provide three new workers to help with the Old Testament translation work that he's doing over there. And also for the Kindervaters, I should be able to say that by now. Married to, the granddaughter. So anyway, the Kindervaters, they are praying for, that seekers in their fellowship will surrender their lives to Christ and testify of their commitment through baptism this year. And Carol was explaining to me this week why that is challenging over there, because if they ask people if they want to be baptized, they're so polite that they will. But there's no actual heart change with that, but they do it as a gesture towards the Kindervaters to do that. So they are trying to figure out a good way to get people to understand their need and to present that as an option to them without asking them, because if you just ask them outright, then they'll say yes whether they mean it or not. So it's a tricky cultural thing that they are balancing over there. So we're going to pray for them now as we begin the service. Please join me. God, we praise you and we thank you for this wonderful time that we have together today. We ask you to prepare our hearts as we come to this time of fellowship and of celebration and of hearing your word. And we also pray for our brothers and sisters around the world. We think of the Nusses, George and Doris, as they are continuing their work in Guinea, as they are continuing their work with the Bible translation. We just ask that you would provide for them workers to help in their translation work. And we also pray for the Kindervaters in Japan. We pray that you would give them wisdom and opportunity to share so that the church there can see their need and they can find opportunities to have some baptisms, that they would see people's lives being changed. Not just that they could be baptizing people, but that people's lives could be changed through their coming to you and realizing their need for you. And we thank you for your continued support of all of us in these ministries. And we ask that we would continue to rely on you in every way. In Jesus' name, amen.
He is risen. Please stand as we join together in worshiping the Lord through song. See what a morning.
Thank you. Philippians chapter 2, verses 4 to 7. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus.
Oh,
working on the song and during children's church, please come forward.
We're going to pray for the service today. We'll be in Luke chapter 12 today. And as I was reading this in preparation for the prayer, it was not lost on me how anxious I was about praying for the passage about anxiety. But also, as I was reading, and he says about laying up our treasures and having our treasure here on earth, and it's slightly different in Luke, but in Matthew, I always think of that reference, laying up your treasure on earth instead of in heaven. And I think quite literally of treasure, which I think is appropriate, but then as I was reading yesterday, I realized there's all of the other things that I treasure. I treasure my children. I have many children, and I do a lot for them. And how dangerous it is for me to get caught up in treasuring them more than I treasure God's will. And so as you listen to today's sermon, I hope that you also reflect on these intangibles that we have in life that are weighing on us and are drawing us, that not just the treasures of money that we have on earth, but the things that we are anxious over continuing to have, the order, the way all your stuff is left on your nightstand when your kids come up and knock it all off. Maybe that's just me, but please join me as we pray for today's service and for the preparation of our hearts. God, we praise you. You are a God who is so wonderful, so glorious, and so marvelous that we find you incomprehensible. And yet, although we cannot find the words to fully describe you, we see your attributes and we know that you are more glorious than we could ever imagine. And yet, in face of a God who is so wonderful, so marvelous, we so easily turn aside and we see all of the other temptations of this world. And we ask that you would continue to grow in us and continue in your patience and your loving kindness, that you would be slow to anger, as we know we are worthy of your wrath. We deserve the wrath that our sin has earned us. And yet you, while still being full of that wrath, have been merciful to us. You are patient, and you have sent your Son to die on the cross for us. And he did not stay dead. He is risen again, and we celebrate that today. And we just ask that you would continue to prepare our hearts, soften our hearts, that we can receive and listen to your word, that we would realize that our true treasure lies with you and within heaven. Amen.
Thank you, Luke, for leading us in that. Good morning, Pleasant View family. He is risen. Indeed. And I want to welcome a lot of unfamiliar faces here this morning, which makes me and us very happy that we have many visitors among us this morning. And my name is Mike. I'm the lead pastor here, one of the elders here. Luke, who just prayed for us and opened the service for us, is also one of our elders. I share that with you because if you hear, what is an elder of a church? If you come back next week, we're studying through 1 Peter, and I'll explain next week not just what an elder is, but what an elder is called to do by God's word. Luke had mentioned at the beginning of the service a couple of families who are serving the Lord as missionaries in other countries. And so if you look at the back wall there, just to give you a little bit of orientation to what we're about here at Pleasant View, you'll see the flag of Japan there. That's for the Kinderwater family that Luke mentioned. And then next to that, just up new this week, the flag for Guinea, George and Doris Nuss, another couple that we support through our resources here at Pleasant View, who are taking the gospel to places in the world very different from the one that we live in, and we are glad to support that work. I'm thankful for an opportunity that I did not plan to let you in a little clearer picture of how we roll here at Pleasant View. Luke texted me yesterday, and he was asking, typically the elders will pray at that position in the service for the text that I'm going to be preaching out of, or whoever's preaching. As Luke was up here praying and sharing that, I realized I texted him the wrong passage for this morning. John 12, if you have a Bible or want to grab the Bible that's in front of you, is where I'm going to be preaching out of this morning. But again, to let you know how we roll here, we're okay with that. We're human. There's only one God, and we're not him. We also trust, I trust, that Luke's prayer and Luke's words were not wasted. You got an additional teaching on anxiety and heart treasure. So if that's the thing that sticks most with you this morning, we're perfectly fine with that. Luke 12 is where you would want to go to read further about that. Luke also mentioned growth groups. And I want to let you know, especially again, because we have a lot of new faces in the room with us, I have no idea, new people, where you stand in your relationship with Jesus. But I do want to let you know that we're in the process right now. We have several growth groups. That's like a small group. It's a smaller gathering than this here, where our people get together and we talk about the Bible together. We pray with one another. We support and encourage one another through those groups. And we're in the process, this just started to happen this week, of forming One of our growth groups that's specifically going to be designed for people who are not yet following Jesus. So it's going to be a group designed for people who are interested in exploring Christianity and learning more about Jesus. We understand it's scary for a lot of people to walk through the doors of a church brand new. There's this pressure almost inherent that you have to act like you have it all together and that you know everything that you need to know about Jesus. We understand that pressure, but we don't buy into it. We believe our church should be a safe place for people who are not yet following Jesus to ask questions about Jesus, about the Bible, about God, about Christianity. And so if that kind of a group sounds interesting to you, something you'd like to be a part of, I just wanted to let you know that, again, we're in process of starting that, hopefully sometime soon. If you hear something this morning out of John 12 that piques your curiosity, you want to follow up and learn more about that, whoever you're connected to here at Pleasant View, or you can let me know, we would love for you to be a part of a group like that, where Becky and I, my wife, will be looking at questions, exploring again who Jesus is and what it means to follow him. Again, I don't want to make assumptions that all of us in here know. Why is this weekend such a big deal for Christians? Good Friday, this morning, the resurrection, we just sang all about it. Why such a big deal? Why is this weekend so crucial for Christians, for those who follow Jesus? And so before I pray for us when we move into John 12, I want to briefly answer that question. There'll be some scriptures on the screen behind me. 1 Corinthians 15, if you want to understand why the resurrection is such a big deal, if you were to ask me, where should I go in my Bible to read about this, 1 Corinthians 15 would be the first place that I would point you to, where the Apostle Paul explains the meaning and the significance of Jesus rising from the dead. I want to read through part of 1 Corinthians 15, again, to set the basis for it. Paul begins that chapter by saying this, "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel that I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, and then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all of the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me." So when we talk about the resurrection of Jesus, according to the Bible, we're talking about historical reality. This was an event that actually happened, and didn't just happen, but there were over 500 witnesses to its reality. Paul goes on later in the chapter to describe again the significance of this event. If you jump down to verse 14, we read this, "And if Christ has not been raised," so Paul here is addressing some in this church he's writing to in the city of Corinth who didn't believe in resurrection. "If Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain." And so there we see some of the significance of resurrection. No Jesus alive from the dead, everything we do as a church, everything we would attribute to faith, Paul says it's in vain. He goes on and describes verse 15. "We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it's true that the dead are not raised." So we're lying about God if Jesus was not raised from the dead. Verse 17. "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins." And so again, Paul's building an argument here, and what he's showing us, again, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, nothing we do matters. Futile is the word that he used there, and we're still in our sins. Verses 19 and 20. "If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied." So again, no resurrection of Jesus, Christians, followers of Jesus, become the most pathetic spectacle on planet Earth. That's the significance of the resurrection. But then verse 20, look at the phrase that begins that. "But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead." And so because Jesus has risen from the dead, the words we're going to look at in John chapter 12 this morning, which Jesus spoke before he was crucified, they are legitimate. They are valuable for us to consider this morning because Jesus who spoke them was crucified and is risen. One more passage from Acts 17 that I want to share this morning that helps orient us to the significance of resurrection. This is the Apostle Paul again speaking here. Acts chapter 17, he's explaining this salvation, this gospel, this good news of Jesus to another group of people, this time in the city of Athens. And he says this, "The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." So clearly that man is Jesus. And what we see here is that Easter is a perfect time for us to address ignorance in our lives, ignorance about Jesus, who he is, what he came to accomplish, and to repent. Another way to understand the word repent is to agree with God. So as we look at the words of Jesus in John 12 this morning, I hope that you will consider repentance. I hope that you'll consider agreeing with what we see there in terms of what Jesus is saying and what he's calling us to. Because there's a judgment that's coming. Scripture speaks to it. How do we know it's going to happen? Because of the resurrection. Because Jesus rose again, all of human history is moving towards an encounter, a reckoning with Jesus. So let me pray for us, and then we'll jump into John chapter 12. We're going to look at verses 19 through 26 this morning. Father in heaven, thank you for your word, and we thank you this morning for your power that raised Jesus from the dead. Because of that, we know this gathering this morning is not in vain. Our faith is not futile. For many of us, we celebrate the fact that we are no longer in our sins. And for those who have not experienced that freedom yet, we know because Jesus is alive, the offer still stands that we might be set free from the power, from the penalty of sin in our lives, and we might follow you and experience the life and freedom that only you can give. We pray that in your power, you would grant that life in this room this morning. In your kindness, Lord, would you call many to repentance? Give us eyes to see, hearts to understand Jesus, and help us to follow him anew. We ask in his name. Amen. John chapter 12. We're going to begin in verse 19. So let me read verse 19, and then I want to give a little bit of context to what's happening here at this stage in John's gospel. John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the first four books in the New Testament, would be the accounts of Jesus' life, typically called the Gospels. So this is John's account of the life of Jesus. And so in chapter 12, verse 19, we read this. "So the Pharisees said to one another," the Pharisees would have been one group of the religious leaders who were on the scene when Jesus was ministering in the flesh. The Pharisees, and they opposed, for the most part, this was a group who opposed Jesus. They were jealous of Jesus. They were furious with Jesus. They considered him a blasphemer, equating himself with God. So the Pharisees, they said to one another, "You see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the world has gone after him." And so to give a little bit of context of what's happening at this stage in John's gospel, right before this was the triumphal entry. If you were here last week, Pastor Clyde preached about Jesus entering Jerusalem. They put the palm branches and their cloaks down on the road. They hailed him as king as he entered Jerusalem for the last time. And so this is right after John's account of Jesus entering Jerusalem, being hailed as king. If you flip back in your Bible to chapter 11, you'll see that this is also chronologically in John's gospel, right after Jesus raised a man from the dead. Now that would get attention. Lazarus had died. Lazarus was part of a family that Jesus loved, and Jesus, with the power of his word, had called this man forth from the grave. And so that's part of what's happening here. And as I mentioned earlier, this is happening before Jesus was crucified. But the words we look at this morning, Jesus is talking about his impending death, his impending crucifixion on the Roman cross. So that gives us some context. And so you saw there, the Pharisees, they're kind of looking at one another, and they've been actively working against Jesus. Some of the gospel writers, the word they use is they've been trying to destroy Jesus for the reasons I mentioned earlier. And they look at themselves at this point after all that Jesus is doing and all of the fame that he's gathering, and they say, you see, we've gained nothing. Look, the world has gone after him. So if we could put this in modern vernacular, in terminology that especially the younger ones among us would understand, what we see here in John 12:19, Jesus is trending. Jesus is trending. Now the Pharisees, there's hyperbole, there's exaggeration here, but all of their work to oppose Jesus and what's happening is they're not pushing him down, but his fame is growing. His fame is spreading. And this typically happens, right? When those in the public eye are willing to stir the pot, to say things and do things, particularly those who are opposed to them, to the things they're saying and doing, it's going to rile opposition. It's going to stir people up. I'm not real big on Twitter. None of you should be surprised to hear that, I hope, at this point. I do follow the news. I can almost guarantee you one thing that was trending on Twitter this week. Elon Musk trying to take over Twitter, I'm certain, would have been trending on Twitter this week. And it was interesting for me to look at that and to read that story, considering this week, considering Jesus. I'm not comparing him to Jesus other than in this way. He was willing to stir the pot. What was it, a $43 billion offer to buy Twitter? And the opposition came out strongly. And that's an unfolding story. So we see this principle at work here. Jesus, because of the things he's saying and he's doing, the opposition is coming out. They're stirred up against him. But not just that, the curiosity. I'm among those curiously watching this Twitter story unfold to see what's going to happen, as are many of you, I'm sure. So we see this principle at play, and what's happening in John chapter 12, verse 19, Jesus is trending. And just to make sure we're aware, Jesus is still trending. Maybe on Twitter today, but Jesus doesn't need Twitter to trend. We are taking our part here in Sagertown this morning, but all around the globe this morning, hundreds of thousands of people are meeting in gatherings like this one. Why? Because of Jesus Christ. Jesus is still trending. So we start there. Let's move on into verse 20. So that, again, helps set the context. Now, among those who went up to worship at the feast, so this is the time there, the Jews mainly, but there are also, we're going to see, some non-Jews coming to Jerusalem. Jesus had already entered triumphantly. They're coming for one of their feast observances. Among those who went up to worship the feast were some Greeks. So in the context here, this isn't necessarily just people from Greece. This would be non-Jewish people, people who feared God, but they're coming to Jerusalem to take place in this feast. So these Greeks, these non-Jews, they came to Philip. Philip was one of Jesus' disciples. Our text tells us who was from Bethsaida in Galilee. And they asked him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and he told Andrew, another one of Jesus' closest disciples or followers, students. And Andrew and Philip went together and they told Jesus. So again, this group of non-Jewish people coming to Philip. Why would they choose Philip? Why would they ask Philip? Well, we're not 100% sure. Perhaps it mentions where he's from. Maybe they were from the same area or were familiar with that area. Maybe they had some kind of connection with. We're not exactly sure why. But they come to Philip, and Philip becomes a bridge. Philip invites Andrew. They become a bridge to Jesus. So again, this is a principle that we see happen all the time. Gaining access to someone above us, someone that maybe we ourselves don't have access to through a common connection. Our denomination, the Christian and Missionary Alliance, our national president, his name is John Stumbo. For those of you who go to Edinburgh Camp this summer, he'll be one of the speakers there. I don't have a direct access to John Stumbo as a pastor of this church. Tim Keller, who is our regional team leader for this part of Pennsylvania, I know that Tim does have direct connection to John Stumbo. They're personal friends and have been for years. If I wanted to have a word, have a meeting with John Stumbo, I would go through Tim Keller. That's the principle. And again, many of us, we apply this in different ways in our lives. That's what's happening here. These non-Jews come, they want to see Jesus. And so their access is Philip. Philip brings in Andrew, they go to Jesus. And so it's interesting, why did they want to see Jesus? People want to see Jesus for all kinds of reasons. We see that all through the gospel accounts. Perhaps they had heard about Lazarus. Who is this man who with his words raised a dead man to life? Perhaps they had heard the stories that he was being hailed as a king. That would certainly garner interest and a desire to see Jesus. Some people think that maybe these Greeks were seeking Jesus because, again, we're not sure the exact chronology, but at some point around this point in his life, Jesus went into the temple and started flipping tables over. And he started driving the commerce out of the temple. And if you remember what he said, quoting from Isaiah, this place, this is not what's supposed to be happening here in the temple of God. This is a house of prayer for all nations, is what he said. So maybe, again, these non-Jewish people, they found hope in those words. Okay, Jesus includes us. Maybe that's why. We don't know. We're not exactly sure why they were seeking to see him. But I want to pause here and I want to ask this question. We already said Jesus is trending. People still want to see Jesus today. How about you? Why do you want to see Jesus? Why would you want to see Jesus? And again, people come with all kinds of motives to see Jesus. Some are just curious to find out about this guy who is still followed by thousands and thousands of people on planet Earth. Some come to Jesus because they've heard of his love and his acceptance. Some come to Jesus because of the way they've heard or maybe experienced he meets needs. He meets physical needs. He meets emotional needs. He meets mental needs, spiritual needs. Some people seek out to Jesus to disprove him. Maybe you know some people like that. There are a lot of famous stories in Christian circles of people who set out to disprove Jesus and ultimately ended up yielding to him, submitting to him. People come to Jesus, they want to see him because of the comfort and the affirmation. Some people seek Jesus because they want to deal with guilt that they feel in their lives. Why would you want to see Jesus? Why would you want an audience with Jesus? And before we move in our text to verse 23, to see how Jesus responds to Philip and Andrew bringing this request from the Greeks, I want to pause and I want to share a few verses out of Isaiah. Isaiah is one of the Old Testament prophets, so this is pre-Jesus in the Bible, before Jesus. But I want to pause here because these words of Isaiah are going to help orient us to what we're about to hear from Jesus in John 12. So what we read in Isaiah chapter 55, really, anytime you consider Christianity, you consider reading the Bible, you consider Jesus, these words speak proper orientation to how we should approach such ventures. Here's what we read from the prophet Isaiah chapter 55, beginning in verse 6. He says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord that he may have compassion on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon." I hope you see the good news in those words there from Isaiah. He goes on. "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." And so what I want us to see here is that as we come to Jesus, as we consider these words of Jesus in John 12, we're coming to someone who is other than us. Now, Jesus is interesting because Jesus is also one of us. This is the idea that that biblical truth that Jesus is both fully man and fully God at the same time. But we need to understand in coming to Jesus that in being fully God, he's other than us. And again, you'll see in just a moment why that's so important. Jesus, during his ministry years, would often make statements equating himself with the Father. He equated himself with God. And so this Lord that we encounter in Isaiah 55 speaks of none other than Jesus himself. Jesus is God, is the message of the Bible. He is the Lord. And in that sense, he is other than us. And that's important because what often happens for us in modern times, really it's happened throughout all human history, is we come to Jesus with our agenda. Have you ever done that? I have. We come to Jesus with our agenda, with what we would like to see done. And what Jesus does time and time again, and you'll see this all throughout the Gospels, Jesus meets our agenda and calls us to meet him on his terms. Jesus is full of grace and truth. Jesus welcomes us to come with our agenda. Jesus doesn't submit to our agenda. Oftentimes, and many of you have experienced this, I know, Jesus shoots our agenda in the best way possible. And he invites us to submit ourselves to him, to his ways, to his purposes. And that's actually a picture of repentance. Again, I said one of the ways you can understand repentance is it's turning around. So I come to Jesus with my agenda, and what Jesus does is he invites me to follow him this way. And again, if you've experienced that, there's pain in that, but I hope by the end you see why that's good news. So with that orientation, let's go back to John 12. How did Jesus respond to Philip and Andrew bringing this request? And so verses 23 and 24, we go on here. And Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." Not what you would expect to read there, is it? If you read down, we never do definitely find out how this encounter with Jesus and the Greeks ended. But what we see Jesus doing here, and again, if you're familiar with John's gospel, Jesus keeps talking about his hour. His hour is his crucifixion, his moving into the tomb, his resurrection, his ascension. That's his hour. Really, though, the crucifixion. And what we see here, Jesus responds to this request of these Greeks to meet with him, to see him. Jesus responds as if something has triggered in the story. Something has significantly shifted here because the disciples bringing this question, all of a sudden Jesus' reaction is, the hour has come for me to be glorified. And again, if you're familiar with the other Gospels, it talks about how he set his face to do the Father's will, which he knew was going to lead him to the cross, to being crucified. And he goes on in verse 24, and he continues to describe that. Look at how verse 24 puts it. "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." Again, at face value, just kind of bizarre. Jesus, there's some Greeks that want to meet you. What does this have to do with? But again, for Jesus, there's this trigger. Now, ultimately, we know Jesus' death was going to throw wide open the door, not just for Jews to know him and to respond to him, but for the non-Jewish people as well. What is he saying in verse 24? I would submit this. You want to see Jesus? If we were going to take that and again put that in modern terms, Jesus uses a picture of a kernel of wheat. Church, you want to see Jesus? Perhaps one of the ways we could think about it is we need to look no further than our garden. Many of us are beginning, some of you are already months into your garden preparation. But look no further than your garden in the sense of when you look at that seed Again, I'm not much of a gardener, but I've done enough that I know a little bit about gardening. I don't plant a bean seed expecting to yield one bean out of that seed. The same way that none of you plant a tomato seed expecting, I'll just be happy if I get one tomato out of this seed. No, we plant seeds expecting multiplication. I titled this message Resurrection Math, and multiplication is what it's about. That's the principle we see at play here in John chapter 12, verse 24. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, Jesus says, it bears much fruit. Jesus is referring to his death. His body is that seed that will die, that will be buried. But the principle, again, that we can witness in our gardens is out of his one death, the single seed dying and being buried, what's going to happen is multiplication out of that. So let me explain that, hopefully in a way that makes sense, because what's happening here? Again, he's explaining his death, and what seems on face value to be a defeat is actually going to yield a bountiful harvest. Again, to understand that, Jesus referring to his death, we need to understand what was happening with Jesus on the cross. And to help us with this, I just want to look at a few scriptures that I think explain that and what Jesus is referring to. Well, why is he on the cross in the first place? We saw this in 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Peter 3:18 puts it this way. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous. So in that equation, Jesus is the righteous one here. And he's on that cross for sins. Peter earlier in chapter 2 of 1 Peter had said, he, Jesus, committed no sin. So Jesus isn't on that cross for his sin. He's on that cross for the sins of the unrighteous, which would be all the rest of us. So that's why Jesus is up there in the first place. What's he doing up there? Why is he suffering for sins? What's happening as he's suffering for sins? Romans 6:23 says this, for the wages of sin is death. And so if you notice in some of the songs we sang earlier, it talked about a payment that was owed, a debt that was paid by Jesus on the cross. That comes out of this idea that our sins come with a price tag attached to them. And it's a price tag, according to the Bible, we can't pay on our own. And so what Jesus is doing there on that cross, Jesus the righteous one, Jesus the one who had committed no sin, he's paying that debt. He's paying that a ransom price is another way the New Testament describes it. That's what's happening on that cross, Jesus making that payment. And so another way, right before the passage in Ephesians 2 that Brett read earlier in the service, we, the unrighteous, are described in this manner. And you were dead in the sins and trespasses in which you once walked. So this is, I hope the dots start to connect. So Jesus is up there paying for sins that are not his. The sins are ours. And lest we might look at ourselves and say, well, it's really not that big of a deal. Here I am, I'm on planet Earth, I'm living my life, I'm doing fine. The problem with that biblically is that Scripture says spiritually, in terms of our relationship with God, our sin makes us dead. We are spiritually dead. We are alienated from God, is another way it puts us. We're enemies of God, is another way it's described. We are separated from the life of God because of our sin. That's what Jesus is doing on the cross, is he's paying the price owed in order to bring us back into right relationship with God. So it makes sense then in John chapter 3, most of us know John 3:16. Earlier in John chapter 3, verse 3, we read Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus, where he says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he will not see the kingdom of God. And so we who are dead in our sins and trespasses must experience a rebirth. We must be born again. And so you start to get this picture. Jesus' death, Jesus' resurrection accomplishing something that's going to show forth in others who are dead being raised from the dead. Spiritually speaking, those who've been alienated from God coming back into right relationship with God through faith. And so Jesus' death, if you've ever pictured or if you've ever been able to watch a Christian baptism, somebody being here at Pleasant View, we do it in a pool right back here. If you've ever witnessed a Christian baptism, that's a picture of what we're talking about here. Romans 6 describes it this way. What shall we say then, the Apostle Paul writes there? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Interesting, the transaction we see there, because we who were dead in our sin, once we come to faith in Jesus, we are now dead to sin and alive to Christ. And our life of faith becomes a picture of being raised to newness of life. We display, we show forth the resurrection power of Jesus. And so the seed, the one seed, the only sufficient seed that died and was buried, Jesus was resurrected. And with that resurrection comes the possibility for us to experience newness of life, to experience resurrection life. That's what Jesus is looking at here in John chapter 12 as he describes his death and the impact of his death. And so the last two verses that we're going to look at this morning, 25 and 26, Jesus goes on, and again, not really what we would expect him to say, but here's where we see we come to Jesus with our agenda, and he lovingly kills it, and he invites us to follow him on his terms. Look at verse 25. Whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Interesting terminology. Again, you'll find this throughout the Gospels. Whoever loves his life loses it. Whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. The love-hate language here, we don't take literally, but it's an issue of priority. In essence, what Jesus is saying is, if you're going to come to me for the life that I offer, I take priority. My plans, my purposes, my agenda take priority over yours. In another place, Jesus says, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me, which is a picture of, again, I come to Jesus, in all of my agenda, I have to be willing to let that die in order to follow him, his plans, his priorities for my life. So whoever loves his life loses it. So again, Jesus in his wisdom is giving us this picture. There are some who will hold on to their life, who will hold on to their agenda, who will hold on to their priority. Jesus says those ones ultimately will lose their life. But for those who are willing to lay that down to give me my plans, my agenda, priority, that person will keep his life for eternal life. Do you see what that is? That's a picture of multiplication, church. So many of us come to Jesus and we're thinking in addition. What I mean by that is this math addition, that I'm going to come to Jesus with my agenda and my plans, and by adding Jesus to my life, it's going to make it that much better. We need to know that that's not the math that Jesus works in, and the resurrection shows us this as clear as anything. Jesus doesn't work in addition that way. Jesus is not going to come alongside you or me simply to bless our little plans. Jesus works in multiplication. And what it looks like is we come to him, we lay our plans down, and what he does is he multiplies life. What we could never have dreamt of, he takes that and he multiplies. And I'm going to give you some specific examples in a minute of what that looks like. Whoever hates his life in this world, Jesus said, will keep it for eternal life. Verse 26. I want you to notice the terminology that Jesus uses three times in this one verse. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And wherever I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. Do you see the theme there? We come to Jesus as servants. He doesn't serve our agenda, we serve his. And again, if you're willing to look at the Bible, to open the scriptures, I think you'll see the agenda of Jesus is a good one. It's always a good one, even when it hurts. That's one of the lessons we've been learning as we've been going through 1 Peter. Even in pain and suffering, he knows exactly what he's doing. And that's what he invites us to. And so we see there, we come to Jesus to serve Jesus. We come to Jesus as servants. And don't miss the last five words of verse 26. The one who serves me, Jesus says, the Father will honor him. God the Father, God the Holy One, the Lord that Isaiah 55 spoke to. One of the things that happens to us as we submit our lives to Jesus, to his agenda for us, is that the very God who created it all, the sovereign over all of human history, everything that's happening in our world right now, Jesus says that he will honor you. Multiplication of life. And scripture talks in a couple of places about this life. Because what happens, it sounds hard. Jesus calls us to himself and he calls us to die to self. But the same principle of verse 24 works for us as we die to self in coming to Jesus. Out of that death, Jesus multiplies life. And again, it's hard. We don't pretend that it's easy. To come to Jesus and to allow our agenda to die, it's always a hard thing. But according to Scripture, it's always a good thing because multiplication that happens, multiplication of life. Scripture describes it in a couple of different ways. The newness of life that we saw in Romans chapter 6. We're dead to sin. Jesus calls us to walk in newness of life. John 10:10. So just a couple chapters before where we're at here, Jesus talks about how he came that we might experience life and life to the full is the way he describes it, or life abundant. That's the life that Jesus offers. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, we read about this life described this way. Paul warns Timothy, as for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but to set their hope on God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is truly life. Jesus calls us to that plane of life that far exceeds anything that we could accomplish chasing or pursuing our own agenda, our own plans. That's what I mean. I believe that's what Scripture means when it's always a good thing when Jesus calls us to lay down our plans. He has something better for us. So let me end by describing some of what it looks like for us to walk in this newness of life. What is this life that Jesus offers? Well, certainly it's salvation. We've sung about it. Jesus' resurrection affirms us. Those of us who have placed faith in Christ, we look forward to a resurrection, to a salvation that will be fully experienced when Jesus returns again. We are his children, we are his people, and we will be with him forever. But it's not just there that we experience the multiplication of life. We experience it here. One of the primary ways that we experience this newness of life, have you ever gotten to the place where you're sick of the person you are? I have, where you look in the mirror and again, I did it again. I said it again. I said I was never going to find myself in this place again, and here I am. One of the ways we experience this newness of life in Jesus, and it multiplies, is the character of Jesus formed in us. As we lay down our plans and we yield ourselves to Jesus in faith and we follow him, Scripture teaches that he begins this work of forming his character in us. What is that character? Galatians 5 is probably the best succinct description of it that we have. Because the Holy Spirit comes to live inside of us when we put our faith in Jesus, and the fruit of the Spirit, maybe is the way you've heard about it, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Those who follow Jesus start to experience growth in those areas as they walk with Him. That's the character of Jesus being formed in us. One of the ways that we experience this newness of life, and that certainly impacts our right here, our right now. We also start to see the priorities of Jesus become our own. I lay down my goals, my plans, my agenda. Well, Jesus has an agenda in this world. Jesus has a work that He's up to. It involves calling others into the fold. It involves calling others, inviting others to come experience this newness of life that we ourselves are experiencing. The way the Bible describes it is we're invited into this work of making disciples, of inviting more people to be students or apprentices of Jesus. One of the phrases the Bible uses, we are ambassadors. So we go and we share this message of Jesus with others, inviting others to come in. And what we find is as we get involved in that work, we're involved in multiplication. God actually uses us to help others come to experience new life in Jesus. So we have this privilege, if the worship team would come up for our closing song. We have this privilege not only to know God in a way that we never did before, but now to make Him known as well. And so just the same way that Jesus died and out of His death came a multiplication of life, we come to Jesus in repentance. We place our faith in Jesus for what He accomplished on the cross in paying for our sins. And we find ourselves caught up in this multiplication of life, the character of Jesus being formed in us and being involved, called into this work of ambassadors, making disciples, calling others to be students of Jesus.
Would you please stand as we sing in response to the message this morning?
Thank you.
want to pray for us and encourage you, church, those of you who are in Christ. I hope this has been a good reminder of why we celebrate the resurrected Jesus. Maybe for some of us, it's been a reminder in a painful way of some places, some areas of our lives that we're still trying to do our own thing. And so this morning was an encouragement for us to yield those areas of our lives to the leadership of Jesus, to experience his multiplying life in places where our agenda is just not, it's not yielding that. For those of you who have not yet placed faith in Jesus, I hope you've been encouraged this morning as well. We saw in Acts chapter 17, Jesus' resurrection, what we celebrate around the world today, assures us that he's coming again. He's coming this time not as Savior, but as Judge. There will be an accounting. And so his invitation is that we would move out of our ignorance. You've heard the word of God related to Jesus today, that we would repent. That we would agree with what God has said about himself, and we'd seek to align our lives with that. If your heart has been pricked in that way, again, I would direct you to whoever you know here, whoever you know that's following Jesus, take your questions, take what the Lord has impressed on your heart to that person, those people, share it with them, and seek Jesus today. Seek Jesus for the life only he can offer. So I want to pray that the Lord would help us as we do that. Father, thank you for the clarity of your word. Jesus, we celebrate you today not as one who died on a cross, but as one who is now living Lord. Seated at the right hand of the Father, you are sovereign over our lives. And so our desire now is that you would come and that you would help us to respond appropriately to what we've heard in your word. For those of us who are following you, would you help us? Would you empower us by your Spirit to yield ourselves ever further to your loving leadership over us? And how we pray again that in your kindness you would call others to repentance for those who have not yet yielded their lives to you, Jesus. Would you continue to impress the truth of your word on their hearts, draw them to yourself, and call them into the abundant life that only you can provide for us. So thank you for how you've met us in your word today. Thank you that we have much to celebrate as your creation, and we look forward to the ways that you're going to lead us out of what we've heard this morning. We pray all of these things in the name of our precious risen Savior, Jesus Christ, and all of God's people said, amen.